Tomorrow the World Cup begins, an historic World Cup, the first shared between two lands, a tournament designed to be an example to the world of cooperation and goodwill. The irony will not be lost on us in Ireland, back on the greatest stage in football for the first time in 8 years. The World Cup is about great teams and great players, about the Zidanes and the Owens and the Benestutas and the Rauls and so many other greats who will entertain, enthrall and fascinate an audience of more than 42,000 million people over the next month. It will be about Ireland, one of the smallest football nations to qualify for Japan and Korea, and let's not forget, against all the odds too. It should have been about Roy Keane, but for a set of circumstances which has denied a world platform to the player who more than any other helped Ireland to qualify for the World Cup for the third time. What lies ahead? No other country celebrates a World Cup like Ireland, says Niall Quinn. And this World Cup should be about music and crack and national celebration. It may well be eventually, but without Roy Keane, not yet. Not after arguably the most dramatic week in the history of Irish sport. John and Eamon are here to preview the delights that lie ahead in terms of football, and indeed to review the fiasco that has seen Ireland's World Cup preparations in tatters. First though, Eamon, you and I have worked together on the World Cup since 1978, and John, you and I for slightly less than that. Has there ever been a sports story like this?
I don't think there's ever been a soccer story that reveals such incompetence and lack of ability to get the job done. I mean, the Irish soccer team now is the laughingstock of the World Cup before we start. And particularly in Britain, where they watch closely, they're laughing particularly hard at the behaviour.
At the minks, as they might put it.
Well, as the Daily Mail wrote yesterday, you know, a sad Irish joke, exclamation mark. So the people responsible for this have damaged themselves, they've damaged sport in this country, and they've made our greatest sportsman and captain, who did more than anyone else to get us there, they've made him redundant, and he's been a victim of a horrible injustice, and it's vicious, it's unpleasant, and all that happy clappy talk we just saw up there is just public relations guff. Everyone in this country who's watched this unfold has an opinion about it. It has interfered with our World Cup celebration, yeah. And it has interfered with celebrating the great achievement of qualifying from a tough group.
Yeah, which was a fantastic achievement. John, interestingly enough, an awful lot of people seem to have lost the appetite for the World Cup when you talk to them. But yet, travelling around Dublin today, the flags are flying on taxis, they're flying on cars and all that. So I wonder, even though we're down at this stage, will it all right itself by Saturday morning once the game begins?
Well, I don't think it'll ever be right. Well, I think a lot of people have lost their enthusiasm for it.
And they won't regain it, you mean, is it?
I don't think fully, no. I think once the matches start, obviously, they get behind the team and that. But I don't think they'll regain it fully from the optimism and the enthusiasm that they had up to a couple of weeks ago. I think once the matches start, then the players who were there representing Ireland, I think
that's an appalling thing to do to a nation, though, in a sense, isn't it? To kill off the sense of enthusiasm, the sense of enjoyment, the sense of national pride that was really going to be part of our lives for the next month.
Well, it is, because they've worked hard to get there. They've done well to qualify for it. Everybody was looking forward to it. And I've no doubt that the fact you can feel it around the place, I think the enthusiasm has been diminished a great deal.
Now, an interesting point there. McCarthy says that no damage, he's rejected the notion that damage has been done to the squad on the grounds that they are professional, they're bonding together again, they're focusing on the football, they're not being diverted by any of the soap opera that's been part and parcel of the Irish camp for the last week, and they're moving forward. You accept that?
Well, you see, Steve Stone said, let's get on with the football. Roy Keane believes that part of the football is preparing to play the football. It's travelling. It's training. It's the drinks you're supposed to consume if they arrive. It's having balls. It's having a proper pitch to train on. Roy Keane believes that, as do all good professionals. Yeah. And he believed that was an imperative. And he's right, of course. No one would dispute that. Can you separate the subsequent injustice to Roy Keane, the victimisation of him?
Except for the
kangaroo court. the lies that were told in the media, the double talk. Can you separate all that out from this team that's going out to represent this country? You can't. It's part of the story. And if you want to follow a team...
And that story diminishes everybody, you mean?
Of course it diminishes everybody. And if you want to support a team, then you want to support a team you respect and people you respect. And that's what's been taken from the heart of it. It's extremely difficult now to respect some of those senior players.
Yeah.
It's extremely difficult to respect Mick McCarthy, and it's impossible to respect the FAI.
Yeah, but we've got to respect what Brendan Menton says. He says that for tactical reasons, a lot of information hasn't come out.
That's not true.
And in due course, it will come out.
That's not true either.
And the real story and the full
story.
That's
not true either. None of those things are true.
How do you know that?
Because I know the story. And I know what's come out. And it's right. It's correct, Larson.
In other words, what you're saying to us, and I don't want to be trawling over old ground, really, but what you're saying definitively is that the Roy Keane version is the correct and definitive version.
It's the truth, Bill. And I think anyone who saw his interview with Tommy Gorman, and most people in this country
Yes, I accept that. The only thing, though, is this, that I'm very much on Roy Keane's side.
No, it's not a question of science. It's a question of truth. Roy Keane has told the truth.
But there is a fundamental truth. And the fundamental truth, I would have thought, and this I think is the essence of your argument, John, the fundamental truth is that he actually put forward the proposition that he wanted to go home. He raised that as an issue in the first instance.
In the first instance, Roy Keane went privately to Mick McCarthy to make representations about the lack of facilities and the bad pitch and all the rest of it, privately. He wasn't given a sympathetic hearing. He subsequently lost his temper on the training ground with a number of people, as happens on training grounds every day. He subsequently said he wanted to go home. An hour later, he reviewed that, realised the significance and the importance of what he's done, and tried to offer an olive branch. That olive branch was rejected.
Yeah.
He was told he was on his way, and that's where McCarthy lost his head. So heads were lost all round.
And this is where...
At the end of the day, no other country in the world would have treated any player like
I think that's a fair point, but John, your fundamental argument is that Roy should never have said he was going home, isn't that? It's essence, what you're saying.
Well, I would differ with Diamond. I'm not pro-Roy Keane or anti-Roy Keane. I've been pushed into it, because of our discussions, pushed into a bit of a corner that I'm anti-Roy Keane. I think Roy Keane had legitimate complaints to make about the trend. That is unacceptable. My objection to it, and Roy Keane's part in this particular story, that despite the fact that he had a non-sympathetic hearing from Mick McCarthy, he did go on the training ground, had a row with a couple of the coaches because there was no goalkeepers, and that blew up with an attack, I believe, on Paddy Bonner and Alan Kelly. Now, once you do that, two wrongs don't make a right. The manager and his coaching staff, and through his coaching staff, is undermined. There's no doubt about that. And then Roy Keane volunteered to go home, and subsequently said that he was talked out of it by other people and didn't really want to be there. Now, that would be my objection to Roy Keane and his part in this particular fiasco. Now, let me just finish, Bill.
Yes, sir.
I've said to him before, I think that despite all those complaints, that he should have stayed.
Yeah.
Because the alternative to that is going home, which I think was too drastic in the circumstances.
Yeah, okay.
Now, I can understand his feelings, I can understand him being annoyed, but I still think in the long run, the best thing would, for whatever it was, 2 or 3 days, get the matches over, go mad with everybody if he wanted to after that. But at least he's playing in the world.
So, John, what's going to come out? What good can come out of this? I mean, you know, what are the lessons that we must learn out of this?
Well, the lesson that you must learn is that there shouldn't be any mess-ups, first of all, in the preparation. Of that. Mistakes were definitely made in that respect. There's no excuse for the balls and the equipment. Whoever was responsible for it, and ultimately it is the manager who's responsible for that.
Yeah.
That should not happen. It should never have happened. And hopefully one of the things that were good things and positive come out, that will never happen again.
Can I just say one thing? In 1994 in the USA, behind all the happy clappy talk, it was a ferocious mess. Jack Charlton was no better than Mick McCarthy at providing the players what they wanted, and we paid the price in Florida. If someone had stood up then, as Roy Keane has stood up now, we wouldn't be facing this situation. And I guarantee you, the next manager of Ireland will We'll make sure that that job is done properly.
All right.
And we will see good come out of this.
Can I ask one final question? You're not going to fall out over this, are you, Buzz?
Certainly not.
No. He couldn't afford to buy too much Bacardi.
Very briefly, can we beat Cameroon and qualify for the group?
Doubt it. No chance.
No chance?
No chance of qualifying for the group.
Really?
No.
I would, take a point against Cameroon now, Bill.
Oh, yeah. Be good to be a good start now.
Because I think if you lose the first match, then you're really up against it.
13 points behind Argentina in the qualifying.
Saw some of those qualifying matches as well, and they had some shocking results, Bill. They were in disarray, but a lot of the players are playing in Europe. The domestic game is weak there, and there's a lack of money and morale, and a sense of chaos around the team. They've given us, I think, the greatest moments in World Cup history, and I'm sure everyone remembers the great Brazilian sides, and if they don't come to the tournament in good shape,
you'd fear for them, would you?
Well, you'd think the tournament has lost a bit of its, you know, magic, because that's what they bring, and Brazilian football is magic. But I don't know.
And Spain, they could face Spain.
Yeah, and it's been a great match. They have outstanding players. If Ronaldo was back and ready to play, we don't know that.
Yeah.
But if he's back and ready to play, they got to the final of France 98, but I don't really think they're going to feature as contenders this time, and that's a shame.
Look at all the 32 teams. What's your judgment at this stage? Who's going to win?
France or Italy?
Italy could sneak it, couldn't they? They'd be easy right all the way to the final.
They wouldn't be sneaking it. They have great players.
But they won't meet Brazil, they won't meet Argentina, they won't meet France until the final if they make it.
They'll be thereabouts, Bill. And if I had to have a bet now, I think they're slightly better valued than France, where Frank Leboeuf is playing. And I don't fancy Frank, but France are wonderful.
Okay, too. Very briefly, John.
I have to go for France, Bill. I think if anybody's going to win it, they're going to have to beat them.
Right.